Channel 9 presents College on Camera, today presented by the University of South Dakota. Here now is the director of KUSD and KUSD-TV, Martin Bush.
It's a distinct pleasure and an honor to have with us today Dr. John G. Neihardt, great epic poet of America. He's best known for a great work which I have in my hand here entitled A Cycle of the West. We're going to hear Dr. Neihardt read from that a little bit later on. Mr. Neihardt has been called an American Homer. He's been honorary professor of poetry at the University of Nebraska, a literary editor for the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, director of information for the Indian Bureau, and has lectured at many colleges and universities. He's a member of the National Institute of Arts and Letters and recently was appointed poet in residence and lecturer in English at the University of Missouri. He is poet laureate of Nebraska. We're going to talk to Dr. Neihardt now. Dr. Neihardt, your Cycle of the West is your great work, which took some 28 years to accomplish, didn't
it? I worked on it 18 years out of an elapsed time of 29, yes.
And would you care to tell us briefly how the thing is put together? There are five separate songs, as you call them, and how you arrange them,
yes,
and what they include.
The cycle deals with what I call the epic period of the American West, beginning in the year 1822, when Ashley and Henry ascended the Missouri River with 100 men, and ending with the Battle of Wounded Knee, which marked the end of Indian resistance on the plains. There are five songs. The first is entitled The Song of Three Friends. I use that word to indicate an epic song that is a part of a longer work. As, for instance, in the Nibelungen Lied, that is the Song of Nibelung, Chanson de Roland, the Song of Roland, and so forth.
Yeah.
And the first is called The Song of Three Friends, and it deals with the Ashley Henry men in the upper Missouri River country. Second is The Song of Hugh Glass. That deals with another adventure of an Ashley Henry man. Then comes The Song of Jed Smith, which has to do with the period of discovery and exploration. Jed Smith led the first body of Americans overland to Spanish California. And the fourth is called The Song of the Indian Wars, which has to do with the last great fight for the bison pastures between the Western white man and the Plains Indians, the Sioux, the Cheyenne, and the Arapaho. And it ends with the death of Crazy Horse. And it's the death of Crazy Horse that Ben and I are going to give you today.
Dr. Neihardt is going to be reading, as he said, the death of Crazy Horse, and we have a special guest, Mr. Ben Black Elk, the son of the great Black Elk of the Sioux Nation, who will be chanting as Dr. Neihardt reads the poem. Dr. Neihardt, this one particular song, or portion of the cycle, which from which you're going to read, the Song of the Indian Wars, received a distinct honor recently, didn't it, as far as the library and the White House was concerned?
Well, some years ago it was chosen as one of 500 books to be the White House Library, taken from world literature. And it was chosen by a national committee.
And the whole cycle also had a distinct honor in being chosen as one of 1,000 volumes, wasn't it?
One of 3,000, so-called best books from Homer to Hemingway, 3,000 years, chosen by a consensus of expert opinion over a period of about 40, 50 years. Yeah.
And, of course, Dr. Neihardt, you had firsthand experience as far as the Song of the Indian Wars was concerned by actually having lived with the Sioux.
Well, I talked to lots of Indians who were in those battles, and I was also the first civilian member of the Order of Indian Wars of the United States, which was composed of army officers who fought on the plains. As old, when I knew them, they were all alive, all those fellows from miles down. And they were good witnesses, and they remembered, and they told me, and then the Indians, too, would show the other side. And many of these battles I describe as a result of my talks with men who were in them, yes.
Well, that's fine. And now, Dr. Neihardt, we're going to listen to you read The Death of Crazy Horse. That's the last chapter of the Song of the Indian Wars.
That's right, last chapter. Now, on January 8th, 1877, Crazy Horse had his village on the Tongue River in Montana. They had burned the prairie off 150 miles wide as they retreated as they fled before the cavalry that fall, and the whole country was desolate. And they were there, and Miles came with a finely equipped body of foot soldiers and attacked him. Blizzard came on during the attack. And Crazy Horse's people had practically no ammunition, and they fought with gun butts and clubs, holding those finely armed men back while the women retreated with the children and the ponies. And they retreated to the Little Powder River, 150 miles south, and there they spent the rest of the winter starving. Ponies eating cottonwood bark, and they eating the ponies as they dropped dead. And we begin at that point. Now, Spotted Tail had surrendered, and he advocated compromise with the white man. And I refer to him as Love of the Whites, not that he especially loved the whites, but they spoke of him that way because he was on the white side then. And he was the uncle of Crazy Horse. So now here we are. The moon was like a frozen bubble blown along the rim of February nights when Spotted Tail, the lover of the whites, came there with mighty words. His cheeks were full, his belly round. He spoke of Sitting Bull and Gaul defeated, driven far away across the line into Canada. Of Red Cloud getting gray before his time, a cougar in a cage, self-eaten by a silent, toothless rage that only made the watching sentry smile. And still the story saddened, the story that Spotted Tail told. All the while the scattered Sioux were coming in to save their children with the food the soldiers gave and laying down their arms and making peace. He told how Dull Knife's fury did not cease but grew upon the soldier food he ate and how his people fattened, nursing hate for Crazy Horse. And many more than these but waited for the grass, the Loup Pawnees, the Utes, the Winnebagoes and the Crows, Shoshones, Bannocks and Arapahoes, with very many more Dakotas, too. Now what could Crazy Horse's people do against them all, said Spotted Tail the Wise. And with the ancient puzzle in his eyes that only death may riddle, gazing long now first upon the fat one in the wrong, and now upon the starving in the right. The other found an answer. I could fight, and I could fight till all of us were dead. But now I have no powder left, he said. I cannot fight. Tell Gray Fox, that's Crook, tell Gray Fox what you saw, that I am only waiting for a thaw to bring my people in. And now 'twas done. Spring found the waiting fort at Robinson, Fort Robinson. A half moon ere the Little Powder knew. And doubting still what Crazy Horse might do when tempted by the herald geese a-wing to join the green rebellion of the spring, the whole frontier was troubled. April came, and once again his undefeated name rode every wind. Ingeniously the West wrought verities from what the East had guessed, of what the North knew. Eagerly deceived, the waiting South progressively believed the wilder story. April wore away, fleet couriers arriving day by day with but the farthing mintage of the fact, bought credit slowly, in that no one lacked the easy gold of marvelous surmise. For gazing northward, where the secret skies were moody with a coming long deferred, whoever spoke of Crazy Horse still heard 10,000 hoofs. But yonder, with the crow and coyote to applaud his pomp of woe, the last great Sioux rode down to his defeat. And now his people huddled in the sleet where Dog Creek and the Little Powder met. with faces ever sharper for the whet of hunger. Silent in the driving rains, they straggled out across the blackened plains where Inyan Kara, mystically old, drew back a cloudy curtain to behold, serene with time's indifference to men. And now they tarried on the North Cheyenne to graze their feeble ponies, for the news of April there had wakened in the sloughs a glimmering of pity long denied. Nor would their trail across the bare divide grow dimmer with the summer for the bleach of dwindled herds. So hard it was to reach the South Cheyenne. Oh, sad it was to hear how all the pent-up music of the year surged northward there, the way it used to do. In vain the catbird scolded at the Sioux, the timid peewee queried them in vain, nor might they hearken to the whooping crane, nor heed the high geese calling them to come. Unwelcome waifs of winter, drab and dumb, where ecstasy of sap and thrill of wing made shift to flaunt some color or to sing the birth of joy, they toiled a weary way, and giddy April sobered into May before they topped the summit, looking down upon the valley of the soldiers' town at Robinson, that's Fort Robinson. Then eerily began among the lean-jowled warriors in the van the chant of peace, a supplicating wail that sped along the clutter of the trail until the last bent straggler sang alone, and camp dogs, hunger-bitten to the bone, accused the heavens with a doleful sound. But silent still, with noses to the ground, the laden ponies toiled to cheat the crows, and famine, like a wag, had made of those a grisly jest. So Crazy Horse came in with twice a thousand beggars, and the din died out, though here and there a dog still howled. For now the mighty one whom fate had fouled dismounted, faced the silent double row of soldiers, haughty with the glint and glow of steel and brass. A little while he stood as though bewildered in a haunted wood of men and rifles, all astare with eyes. They saw a giant, shrunken to the size of any sergeant. Now he met the glare of Dull Knife and his warriors waiting there with fingers itching at the trigger guard. How many comrade faces, strangely hard, were turned upon him. Ruefully he smiled. The doubtful supplication of a child caught guilty. Loosed the bonnet from his head and cast it down. I come for peace, he said. Now let my people eat. And that was all. The summer ripened. Presages of fall now wanted nothing but the goose's flight. The goldenrods had made their torches bright against the ghostly imminence of frost, and one long brooding on a birthright lost, remembered and remembered. Oh, the time when all the prairie world was white with rime of mornings, and the lodge smoke towered straight to meet the sunlight, coming over late for happy hunting. Oh, the days when winds kept silence in the far blue haze to hear the deep grass valleys running full of fatling cows and thunders of the bull across the hills. nights given to the feast, when big round moons came smiling up the east, to listen to the drums, the dancing feet, the voices of the women, high and sweet above the men's. And Crazy Horse was sad. There wasn't any food the white man had could find his hunger and assuage. Some saw a blood-mad panther in a cage, and some the sulking of a foolish pride. For there were those who watched him narrow-eyed the whole day long, and listened for a word to shuttle in the warp of what they heard, a woof of darker meaning. Then one day, a flying tale of battles far away and deeds to make men wonder stirred the land. How Nez Perce Joseph led his little band with Howard's eager squadrons in pursuit across the mountains of the Bitterroot to Big Hole Basin and the day-long fight, and how his women fleeing in the night brought off the ponies and the children too. Oh, there was virtue in that tale to feed the withered heart and make it big again. Not yet, not yet, the ancient breed of men had vanished from the aging earth. They say there came a change in Crazy Horse the day the Ogallalas village buzzed that news. So much to win and only life to lose. The bison making southward with the fall, and Joseph fighting up the way to Gaul and Sitting Bull. Who knows the dream he had? Much talk there was of how his heart was bad, and any day some meditated deed might start an irresistible stampede among the Sioux, a human prairie fire. So back and forth along the talking wire, that's the telegraph to Washington where the trouble was made. So back and forth along the talking wire, fear chattered. Yonder far away is morn, the mighty herd, the politicians down there, the mighty herd, and heard the little horn still roaring with the wind of Custer's doom. And there were troopers moving in the gloom of midnight to the chaining of the beast. But when the white light broke along the east, there wasn't any Ogallala town, and Crazy Horse had vanished. They thought, now he's on the warpath. Up and down the dusty autumn panic horsemen stirred, till all the border shuddered at the word of how that terror threatened every trail. He'd merely gone to see his uncle. They found him in the camp of Spotted Tail, a lonely figure with a face of care. I am afraid of what might happen there, he said. So many listen what I say and look. I will not run away. I want my people here. You have my guns. But half a world away, down in Washington, the mighty ones had spoken words like bullets in the dark that wreak the rage of blindness on a mark they cannot know. Orders had come from Washington to seize him, take him over to the Union Pacific. They were going to ship him down to the Dry Tortugas off Florida and imprison him for life, this man who had done nothing but defend his people. Then spoke the one who led the soldiers, the squad that went to find him. Then spoke the one who led the soldiers, not a hair upon your head shall suffer any harm. If you will go to Robinson for just a day or so and have a parley with the soldier chief. He spoke believing, and he won belief. So Crazy Horse went riding down the west, and neither he nor any trooper guessed what doom now made a rutted wagon road the highway to a happier abode, where all the dead are splendidly alive and summer lingers and the bison thrive forever. if the better hope be true. There was a gate of glory yawning through the sunset when the little cavalcade approached the fort, and this is what they saw. The populous parade, the straining hush that somehow wasn't peace, the bristling troops, the Indian police drawn up as for a battle. What was wrong? What made them hustle Crazy Horse along among the gleaming bayonets and eyes? There swept a look of quizzical surprise across his face. He struggled with the guard. Their grips were steel. Their eyes were cold and hard like bayonets. There was a door flung wide. The soldier chief would talk with him inside and all be well at last. And this is what he saw. The stifling, dim interior poured terror over him. He blinked about and saw the iron bars. Oh, nevermore to neighbor with the stars or know the simple goodness of the sun. Did some swift vision of a doom begun reveal the monstrous purpose of a lie? The desert island and the alien sky, the long and lonely ebbing of a life. The glimmer of a whipped out butcher knife dismayed the shrinking squad, and once again men saw a face that many better men had died to see. Brown arms that once were kind, a comrade's arms whipped round him from behind, went crimson with a gash and dropped aside. "Don't touch me, I am Crazy Horse," he cried, and leaping doorward, charged upon the world to meet the end. A frightened soldier hurled his weight behind a jabbing belly thrust, and Crazy Horse plunged headlong in the dust, a writhing heap. The momentary din of struggle ceased. The people closing in went ominously silent for a space, and one could hear men breathing round the place where lay the mighty. Now he strove to rise, the wide, blind stare of anguish in his eyes, and someone shouted, "Kill that devil quick!" A throaty murmur and a running click of gunlocks woke among the crowding Sioux, and many a soldier whitened. Well they knew what pent-up hate the moment might release, to drop upon the bungled farce of peace a bloody curtain. One began to talk, it was the commandant of the fort. One began to talk, his tongue was drunken and his face was chalk. But when a half-breed shouted what he spoke, the crowd believed, so few had seen the stroke, nor was there any bleeding of the wound. This what they told the people. It seemed the chief had fallen sick and swooned. Perhaps a little rest would make him strong. And silently they watched him borne along a sagging bundle, dear and mighty yet, though from the sharp face, beaded with the sweat of agony, already peered the ghost. They laid him in an office of the post, and soldiers, forming in a hollow square, held back the people. Silence deepened there. A little while, it seemed the man was dead. He lay so still. The West no longer bled. Among the crowd, the dusk began to creep. Then suddenly, as startled out of sleep by some old dream-remembered night alarm, he strove to shout, half rose upon an arm, and glared about him in the lamp-lit place. The flare across the ashes of his face went out. He spoke, and leaning where he lay, men strained to gather what he strove to say, so hard the panting labor of his words. I had my village and my pony herds on powder where the land was all my own. I only wanted to be let alone. I did not want to fight. The gray fox sent his soldiers. We were poorer when they went. Our babies died, for many lodges burned and it was cold. We hoped again and turned our faces westward. It was just the same out yonder on the Rosebud. Gray fox came. The dust his soldiers made was high and long. I fought him and whipped him. Was it wrong to drive him back? That country was my own. I only wanted to be let alone. I did not want to see my people die. They say I murdered long hair. That's Custer. They say I murdered long hair, and they lie. His people came to kill us, and they died. He choked and shivered, staring hungry-eyed, as though to make the most of little light. Then, like a child that feels the clutching night and cries the wilder, deeming it in vain, he raised a voice made lyrical with pain and terror of a thing about to be. I want to see you, Father. Come to me. I want to see you, Mother. O'er and o'er his cry assailed the darkness at the door, and from the gloom beyond the hollow square of soldiers quavered voices of despair. We cannot come. They will not let us come. But when at length the lyric voice was dumb and Crazy Horse was nothing but a name, there was a little withered woman came behind a bent old man. Their eyes were dim. They sat beside the boy and fondled him, remembering the little dreams he knew, the little names he knew before the great dream took him. And he grew to be so mighty. And the woman pressed a hand that men had feared against her breast, and swayed and sang a little sleepy song. Out yonder in the village all night long, there was a sound of mourning in the dark. And when the morning heard the meadowlark, the last great Sioux rode silently away. Before the pony drag on which he lay, an old man tottered, bowed above the bier. A little wrinkled woman kept the rear, without a sound and nothing in her eyes. Who knows the crumbling summit where he lies, alone among the badlands? Coyotes prowl about it. The voices of the owl assume the day long sorrow of the crows. These many grasses and these many snows.
Channel 9 has presented College on Camera, produced and developed by the State University of South Dakota. This has been a Channel 9 studio production, directed by Jim Henry.